Regarding Comrade Jade has obviously sparked a very important debate in the country. It was his action which led to this meeting today. I must say, contrary to what Comrade Jade said, I did invite Jade on Monday and he said affirmatively he would be here. So on that basis we organized the meeting. But unfortunately, a few minutes before the meeting, he said he's no longer able to attend because of the suspension. He has to meet with his colleagues and his comrades to sort the situation. So he said he's in fact very sad that he can't be here, and I think we're all a little bit disappointed that we are not able to enjoy his good company tonight. As a young radical, he has definitely raised questions which should make us all think very hard about the situation that we're facing. I want to just remind you of what the actual situation is in this country. Namibia, according to the latest studies, is the second most unequal country in the world in terms of wealth redistribution. Yes? In Namibia, 5% of the population controls 70% of the wealth. The poorest 50% have only access to 3% of the wealth. This is according to the statistics of the National Planning Commission. We find in Namibia that less than 1 in 10 households, that's to say, less than 10% of people can afford a low-income house. Even a low-income house, only 1 in 10 households can afford that. If you're looking for an average house in Bantu, you have to look for about 775,000. You have to earn at least 23,000 in your household to have an average house in Masdao, at a 2- or 3-bedroom house. Now, this raises questions about our human rights, because we know for a fact that the majority of people in this country earn less than $2,000 a month. The people that earn more than $23,000 are in a very small bracket of about 5% of the population is in this bracket that earns more than 23,000. So, which means most people can't afford an average house. This is something which you are justified to be outraged about and furious, in fact, because I tell you why. There's a subtle violence in this inequality. You can kill somebody without shooting them. You can kill them without even hurting, yes, touching them. All you have to do is you have to deprive them of water, deprive them of a home, deprive them of food, and they will die. Yes. Now, the country is in such a sad state that 3,000, listen to me, 3,000 children die every year for lack of sanitation, for not being able to wash their hands. I'm talking about children under the age of 5. 3,000 children a year, that means 50 children die every week without making it into the news. And why? They're dying from diarrhea, they're dying from dysentery, they're dying from preventable diseases and curable diseases. Now surely this must make us sick. This must disturb us, yes, to the root of our core. Yes. Are we the kind of people who tolerate such things?
No!
This is a country. I come from Walvis Bay and I had to travel here to meet you. I come from a big fishing community, right? The amount of fish we export from this country, if I just took the horse mackerel, we export so much horse mackerel that if we divided it between the 2 million people in this country, each one would get 450 kilograms. Yeah. We're not talking about hake and monk and the other fish. So I'm asking you, if you are exporting so much food, how come these children are dying of hunger? And I want to tell you for a fact, when you talk about stunting development, people talk about development as if it's a purely economic term. But I want to tell you that 3 in 10 children will never reach their natural height. They will never grow to their full potential. You will find those children will stay small, because they never had enough protein for their body to grow to the full height.
Yes.
And their brain, you know what the brain is composed of? Protein. It's made of protein. And if the child has lack protein, his brain cannot grow. You are sending him to school without protein. The brain is not made up of literature. The brain is made up of protein. So those test scores, when you see the children failing, those are not a reflection of their talent or their capacity. It's a reflection of their conditions at home. Because how can a starving child who has no electricity, who cannot wash his face in the morning, he has to go with dirty clothes to school? It's not in a sick to a poor heart. This is a country that subsidizes the supply of water for the mines. Why would we not subsidize the supply of water for the poor and impoverished people? We're talking about the promised land and how we're going to get there. But remember, land is not all that you want. Because a piece of land without water is not good to you, my friend. No? Do you want to live in a land without water?
No.
We're talking about service land. Land with services, right? You can ask, why did I bring this fight to Kanatura today? Because I want to advise them that if you want legitimacy, if you want a mandate, and if you want to win your fight, you must come here to the people, to where the people are.
Yes.
And you get your support from the people. And from here, you can mobilize and you can go as far as you like. As we said, if it's a question of power, the power is with the people. And the people are here. So we start the fight here. Take it from there. Shortly, my proposal is that we must fight for an amendment to the Constitution to provide for one earth for every citizen to be provided.